Next, let's move on to the definition of something called correlation coefficient. This is actually very closely related to covariance. But generally what happens is covariance can be very large or can be very small. Okay. So if it's close to zero, I guess it's fine, you know, it's uncorrelated. But how do you make sense of the actual value of the correlation? Let's say the covariance is 100 or it's 10 or it's 1. Okay. It seems like it's going all over the place and you don't have a sense of how strong the correlation is depending on how high the value of the covariance is. Now, this correlation coefficient is sort of a normalized version of the covariance, and it ends up giving you that real handle on how strong the correlation is based on its value. You'll see why. So this is the definition of the correlation coefficient, or simply correlation, some quite often. Rho of xy, we'll use the notation rho of xy for it. It's covariance of xy divided by standard deviation of x times the standard deviation of y. Okay. So we sort of normalize it. We'll see why this is a very meaningful normalization soon enough. So this is the definition. Once again, we know how to calculate it given the joint distribution of x and y. We can find the variance of x, variance of y. From there, find the standard deviation of x, standard deviation of y. Find the covariance of x, y. We saw examples just now. And then divide and you get the answer. Okay. So here is a very, very important result. It turns out the covariance of x, y lies between minus standard deviation of x times standard deviation of y and plus standard deviation of x times standard deviation of y. Okay. So look at that. So the covariance of x, y is bounded in value. When if you give the standard deviation of x and standard deviation of y, you know that the covariance lies between these two values. It could be both positive or negative, but it lies between these two values. I'm not going to give you a detailed proof of this result, but it's an important result. And I've given you just a pointer to this proof. Okay. So you can look at this expected value and you just simplify using linearity of expectation. You will get to the covariance lower bound or the upper bound depending on which one you take. This is just expected value of a positive positive random variable being positive, right? So use that and you can get it. Okay. So I leave this as an exercise to you. Okay. So now we have normalized, right? So we've normalized. So because of this property of covariance, you know that the correlation coefficient is between minus 1 and 1, okay, whatever may be the random variable x, y, okay, correlation coefficient might be very large, but it's still bounded by the standard deviations, and when you divide by the product of the standard deviations, you get a number, it's dimensionless quantity, it lies between minus 1 and 1, okay, so if the rho of x, y is equal to 0, then you know it's uncorrelated. If rho of x, y tends to 1, it's very positively correlated. If rho of x, y tends to minus 1, it very heavily negatively correlated. So the value of rho of x, y also tells you the extent of the correlation. Okay. So rho of x, y is just one number which summarizes the trend. Okay. Trend is also a good way to say, express this correlation, right? If x were to increase, y would also tend to increase, right? So it's a trend. It's close to 0. They're uncorrelated, there's really no observable trend between x and y, it's sort of all over the place, maybe they're not even related to each other. If it is 1 or minus 1, okay, if rho of xy becomes equal to 1 or rho of xy becomes equal to minus 1, then it turns out, here is a very, very surprising and very powerful property, y is a linear function of x, okay. I'm not going to prove it to you in detail, maybe you've seen this result before in an earlier class, but this is something very, very important to remember, okay. If rho becomes equal to 1 or if it becomes equal to minus 1, then y has a linear dependence on x, okay. Y equals ax plus b. And that's a great thing to know. So such a strong connection is there between y and x. If x is given, y is determined not just directly, but I mean, it's a linear function of x, okay? So if the modulus of rho of x, y is close to 1, then x and y end up being very strongly correlated. If you have an increase in x, you expect an increase in y also, okay? So this kind of understanding of correlation and covariance is important. Once again, these are just numbers to quickly understand the trend between two random variables. Okay, so here's a problem. You have a joint PMF where x is between minus 1 by 4 and 1 by 4, and we're going to find the correlation coefficient or covariance or something just to get more practice into this whole thing. So you can do Fy and Fx, right? So this is 1 half, 1 half, 1 half, 1 half. So expected value of y is a half. expected value of x is a half and expected value of xy. Okay. Remember xy, if x is 0, it's not going to play a role. If x is y is 0 also, it just goes off. Only this guy will play a role. It is just 1 by 4 minus x. Okay. Is that all right? So, the covariance of xy is 1 by 4 minus x minus half into half, which is minus x. Okay. So, you see how covariance nicely works out. So, how do you find rho of xy? You need expected value of x squared and y squared for that. Expected value of y squared is also, okay. So, expected value of y squared is also a half. Expected value of x squared is also a half. Okay. So, variance of x is half minus 1 by 4, that's 1 by 4, and similarly variance of y is also 1 by 4. Okay, you can sort of see why all these things end up being the same thing. Hopefully it's clear to you. Okay, all right. So these two variances are 1 by 4, 1 by 4. So if you do rho of xy, you're going to get the covariance divided by the two standard deviations, that's half into half. So, you get minus 4 times x. Okay. So, you can see as x varies between minus 1 by 4 and 1 by 4, rho of xy will vary between 1 and minus 1. Okay. So, you can see how if x is positive, you expect a sort of a negative correlation, right? If x is positive, then when x is 1, y is more likely to be 0. Okay. So, it's sort of when x is above its expectation, y is going to be below its expectation. Okay, so that negative and positive also comes in very clearly. So that's why this covariance is negative. Okay, so hopefully this gave you a quick way of getting to this is a small problem where you very quickly see how the rho and covariance of xy can be computed. Okay. Okay, so now let's look at a slightly modified version of the previous problem. In the previous problem, we had x equals 0, x equals 1, and y equals 0, y equals 1. I'm going to sort of translate it. I'm going to make x equal to c and x equal to c plus 1, and y equals d and y equals d plus 1, and see what happens to the covariance, okay? So, in some sense, we have a sense that the covariance should not change, right? So, the variance should not change. Hopefully, it doesn't change. Let's see or if it's similar enough, okay? So, let's go through and compute fy. And that's still the summation here, so that doesn't change, half, half. Similarly, fx here, and that's again half, half, that's good. So, what about expected value of y? It's half times d plus half times d plus 1, and that's going to become d plus half. So, the expected value is sort of shifted to the center. Instead of being half, you're getting d plus half. And expected value of x is similarly going to be c plus half. Now, there are various ways of doing the expected value of xy. Maybe we can just do it directly. So, let's just do expected value of xy. It's going to be cd times 1 by 4 minus x, c, and all these things will work out. So, let me just do that. Cd times 1 by 4 plus minus x plus c times d plus 1 times 1 by 4 plus x plus c plus 1 times d times 1 by 4 plus x plus c plus 1 times d plus 1 times 1 by 4 minus x. Okay, so let's just combine the terms together. So, if you look at the cd term, you have a cd term 1 by 4, 1 by 4, 1 by 4. So, you'll get overall a cd. And then if you want to look at the, the c term here, there'll be a c term here, and then there'll also be a c term here, and 1 by 4 plus x and 1 by 4 minus x. So, you'll get a c by 2. Okay, do you see that? There is a c term here, c into 1, and that's 1 by 4 plus x. And likewise, here also there is a c into 1 and 1 by 4 minus x that adds up to give you 1. Okay, so it will give you a half, so c by 2. And likewise, if you look at a d term, okay. So, again 1 by 4 plus x and 1 by 4 minus x, so you get a d by 2. And then finally, you have the one term, and the one term just appears only there. Okay, so hopefully you see how I got that. The one term appears only there, so you will just get a 1 by 4 minus x. Okay, so you saw how I did the simplification. It's not very complex, but you can see how I did that. So now if you do the covariance of xy, you get expected value of xy minus expected value of x times expected value of y. And if you multiply these two, you see the cd, c by 2, d by 2 and 1 by 4. All of these guys will cancel and you will be left with the minus x. Okay, so that's a pleasing answer. So you see that you got the same minus x when you did before as well. Okay, so same thing you can do with rho of xy and you will get the rho of xy to be minus 4x as well. Okay, so you can check this out. If you don't believe me, do the calculation, you will get the answer. Okay. So this sort of shows that this covariance and all that is nicely defined. If you keep translating it all over the place, you get the same covariance, but the relationship between the random variables sort of remains the same. Okay. So one very important aspect of sort of figuring out correlation and covariance is by looking at what are called scatter plots. Okay. What are scatter plots? So this is an example of a scatter plot. I have two variables, two variables. Maybe you can think of this as data, right? So you get a bunch of data for x and a bunch of data for y, okay? Two random variables which you think are correlated. You get a bunch of data and you don't know if they're correlated or not. You want to understand maybe they're correlated, maybe they have a relationship. How do I figure it out? You can do something called a scatter plot. What is the scatter plot? Scatter plot is every x and every y that you got together. So in an observation, you saw an x and a y. You simply plot the point, put an x in x comma y, okay? So these are these dots, okay? And then the first case, there are six cases here, case 1, case 2, case 3, case 4, case 5 and case 6. Let's focus on case 1, okay? So in case 1, so every dot here represents a possible point that you saw, okay? So data point that you saw. So if you just look at this data, it sort of looks all over the place, okay? So you can't conclude from here if there is a trend that, you know, if x is increasing, y is going to increase or anything like that, right? So let's go to case 3, contrast it with case 3, okay? So look at the contrast here. So here, even though the data is sort of spread out, it's not like, you know, x is fully determined by y or something, but still there is clearly a positive trend, isn't it? A positive correlation here. Isn't it? If x is going to increase, then y is also going to increase. So you see that straight line positive correlation. In fact, the correlation here is probably very close to plus 1. Okay? Why is that? Because, you know, you see this band, it's lying within the same small band and it looks like almost like a straight line in some sense, right? So let's come back to this 2. There seems to be a positive correlation, okay? It sort of looks like in that direction. If x is higher, y is going to be higher in some sense, and maybe not that close to 1, right? So may not be very close to 1. Okay, may not be very close to plus 1, but positive correlation, okay? So on the other hand, if you look at this 4 and 5, these two guys are very likely to have negative correlation. Do you see why this correlation is negative? It sort of goes down in this angle. If x is going to if y is going to decrease, then x is also going to increase, right? So it goes down like this. So if y is falling down, x is increasing, okay? And likewise here, this also is probably negative correlation. So between these two, between 4 and 5, you can see that 4 is probably close to minus 1, okay? So this 5 may not be that close to minus 1, okay? So it's a little, there is correlation, but maybe not that strong. So this guy and 1 and 6 are probably uncorrelated, close to uncorrelated, okay? So in this case, rho is probably close to 0, okay? So this is all rho, okay? Okay, Okay, so the rho is probably close to 0. Okay, so this kind of a picture is very useful, particularly when you deal with real data, large data set. How do you quickly see if there are two random variables, or data representing two random variables, are they correlated or not? You simply do a scatter plot, and just by looking at the scatter plot, you can sort of guess whether the correlation is positive, negative, or it's close to 1, minus 1, or it's sort of maybe middling correlation. Is there a general sense? Okay, so I picked nice scatter plots here. Actual scatter plots that you see may not be like this. Later on, we'll see some scatter plots from the IPL and see if we can conclude something interesting based on that. Okay. Okay, so that's, I think, all I wanted to say about covariance and correlation. So once again, this lecture focused on relationship between two random variables and coming up with one number to capture a trend between two random variables. If one random variable is going to be above its average, is the other one also going to be above its average, or is it going to be vice versa? That's the question we asked to try and settle in this lecture. Covariance and correlation are very useful metrics for that purpose.